why I love Jackson so much, that it gave me that relationship. It gave me a queen who is a crown to my head. Listen, what we are engaged in now is quite honestly the most critical election that we have seen in the history of our country. And so failure is not an option. We have to make certain that we get this right. And I appreciate the announcement that we're going to keep it positive, because that's important. You're going to hear a lot about what is wrong with Jackson. But I'm more interested in those solutions, more interested in the plan that's going to move us forward. And so that's what I'm going to share with you today. Now, I'm going to be honest about the facts. I'm going to be honest about the truth, and I'm going to be honest about how we get to that place. Let me start by saying that we have a huge infrastructure problem. I'm not telling you anything that you don't know. Our roads are absolutely horrid to drive on, and I canvass every week, so I can tell you that they're hard to walk on. And worse yet, our pipes are in a worse condition than the roads that we see every day. We have a billion-dollar infrastructure issue in the city of Jackson. And so we have to have a true plan that will see the solution to that billion-dollar issue. And as I see it, the 1% plan, the 1% sales tax, is not being utilized in the fashion as it should be. It was always the intent of Mayor Lumumba to leverage that money. Right now, we're only seeing approximately $15 million a year for the 1% sales tax. For a billion-dollar infrastructure issue, we're only seeing approximately $15 a year. So it isn't even a drop in the bucket. So by the time we get the last dollar that is expected for the 1% sales tax plan, the first road we repair will be in a worse state than it was before we got the money. And so the question then becomes, how do we leverage the money? How do we make the money work? And so the plan for the Lumumba administration, which is not being carried out now, first of all, before I get to that, let me let you know one more fact about that 1% that I feel is a failure to communicate to the people. The 1% sales tax plan was amended after the vote, after the citizens of Jackson voted by 90% to pass the 1% sales tax, the state legislature then went back and took out sin tax. They took out the tax on beer and liquor and cigarettes, and many of you were never told that. In fact, as an attorney, I would tell you more than likely you had a lawsuit against the state of Mississippi, because that is a Voting Rights Act violation. You can't amend a vote after it takes place. That's the equivalent of voting for Hillary Clinton, them amending the ballot, and then saying your vote was for Trump. And that should have been communicated to you. So I believe that that was a failure. But the other thing that you need to know about this 1% sales tax is how we make it utilize it properly. The plan of the Lumumba administration was to leverage the money. You could leverage a stream of revenue just as your house is an asset. You can use your house as an asset to get more money. You can use streams of revenue, and Jackson at the time had a bond rating which was attractive enough to give us the ability to leverage that money. And we saw a mechanism by which we could leverage that money to somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 million. $500 million cannot resolve all of the billion-dollar issues, but it can certainly put a big dent in. It can certainly put a big dent in, and there are other things that we have to do in order to get the money necessary to fix our roads. But I cannot support it. What you will hear today is about this legislative agenda to bring forth this capital complex district that is supposed to be a benefit to the city. I have been vocal and consistent that that is not a good deal. It is not a good deal because it only offers about $24 to $30 million annually. Another drop in the bucket. And it's going to require a commission on the city appointed by the governor. That just yesterday, when it was brought before the House, members of the Hinds County delegation had objection to it because they hadn't even been communicated to. That brought up and championed by a Rankin County Republican who brought the bill. And it's already been indicated that some of the members of that board, that commission, will be members from Rankin County. So what do you have in effect? You have Rankin County representation making decisions on how we develop Jackson, giving the contracts of how we develop Jackson. And I've heard other candidates in this race say, well, no, it's not the best deal. It's not the best deal, but how else are we going to get the money? Well, you need to be clear that not all money is good money.
That's right.
Not all money is good money, and you cannot sell the house to pay the rent. You cannot sell the house to pay the mortgage, right? And so that's why we have an issue with it. Listen, I will admit that at its inception, the idea was good, but when they start turning it into something entirely different, that looks only to feed off the backs of the people of Jackson, and don't let anybody tell you that they're giving you money. It's your money to begin. It's your money to begin, right?
Yeah.
And so we have to have a deal that works for Jackson, and we cannot sell the house to pay the rent and make the decisions that will make it a worse condition than what you're seeing today. And so how do we do that? We have to explore the possibility of leveraging this money. We have to explore the possibility of building public and private partnerships. And we do have to demand that the state and the county do their fair share. But we can't come to agreements that don't benefit us. And don't let anyone tell you how you get business done. People will tell you, I have friendships. I'm respected, and I play golf with certain people in the legislature, and that's going to enable me to get deals done. The way you get work done has very little to do with friendships. It has to start at a place of respect. I practice law not only in Jackson, Mississippi. I practice in Fulton County. I practice in Neshoba County. I practice in many places where the opposition doesn't look like me, nor do they share the same politics that I share. But I'm able to get work done because they respect me. They know that I'm going to give my all. They know that I'm going to spend day in and day out working for that client and being an advocate for them. And so I'm able to get work done because they understand and respect that. And so in the process of getting business done, if a friendship develops along the way, fine. That's icing on the cake. That's beautiful. But we need to restore respect to our leadership. One of the major components in which companies invest in stock markets, or people invest in stock markets for companies, is who's at the helm. How much they respect that leadership. And so that's what we have to see. We have to see the integrity and the principles of working for the people and putting people before politics. That's what we have to see. And I have to tell you, when we're talking about this issue, because we can't talk about roads without talking about the budget. And how do we correct the budget? First of all, I would share with you to articulate that a deficit was inherited is factually incorrect. If you don't believe me, check the Clarion Ledger. In fact, it was a surplus that was inherited. Now, there were some things coming down the pipe that were going to be coming for maturity that were going to cause an issue in the budget. But if you see that the city of Jackson has debts that are accruing, you don't provide the highest administrative budget in the history of Jackson. Under Harvey Johnson, the public works director made $88,000 a year. Under the current administration, Keisha Powell, who just left, was making $150,000 a year. Under the Lumumba administration, the public works director was making $73,000 a year. And it's not to say that that position, or the work, or what people have to put into that job isn't worth all of $150,000. It probably is. But if you were to sue me for $1 million today, you will never see it because I don't have $1 million. But the same principle exists when we talk about the city of Jackson. We have to be able to operate under the principle of shared sacrifice. I'm willing, just as my father was, and you never heard about it because it was not a political point. He tried to go to the legislature to reduce the mayor's salary. Because I would rather take $20,000 out of the mayor's salary in order to recruit the best talent. so that I can show them that I'm willing to do the same shared sacrifice that I'm asking them to. I believe people work for you better. They work for you stronger when they work with you as opposed to working for you. And so that's the same spirit, the same sacrifice, the same willingness we have to express. In fact, it's the same sacrifice that the citizens of Jackson have expressed. When in the history of Jackson or any other city have you seen people vote 90% to tax themselves?
Never.
What that indicates is that people are ready for a change. That they're committed and willing to do with all that it takes in order to make it happen. And we have to demonstrate the leadership that shows the same thing, that shows that same willingness. And so that's where we find ourselves today, answering these questions of how are we going to turn this around. I don't care whether you boarded the ship to begin with, whether you swam to it, or whether you were airlifted here. We're in the same boat now. We're in the same boat now. Amen. And so we have to pull our resources together. When I say, when I become mayor, you become mayor. I'm not saying that all of y'all are going, we're going to have the biggest desk known to man. The biggest office known to man. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that people have to have or play a bigger role in their governance. Amen. We often find ourselves disappointed in our leadership because we take what someone tells us around election. People come around and tell you all of the things that they can do when nothing in their past actually indicates they're capable. And so what we have to do is draft our own agenda. Draft what we want to see in our community as a community. And draft the leadership which represents our interests and is committed to the agenda that we create. And so that's why I stand here today. Not because I have some high aspiration to be some lifetime politician. But I think leadership must be born more out of necessity and less out of political ambition.
Man.
So I'm going to try my best. You know, there's a lot to talk about. But I'm going to try my best to get to some other strategic plans. As we talk about this budget, as I was initially going into, we have to reduce that administrative budget. We have to reduce those administrative salaries. And we have to become in greater balance between the work we outsource and the work we do in-house. Right now, we're out of balance. Every contract, we're looking to issue to someone. And the way it works is these companies come with sweetheart deals that give you the lowest possible amount of money that they can do the job for and give you a little bit of a cut. Until they reduce your capacity to do the work, to an extent that their next contract, you don't have the workforce, the know-how, or the ability to do the work. And so you're at the mercy of the company. Jackson used to collect its own trash. But we don't do that. I look forward to speaking with you soon so that I can talk specifically about South Jackson. I was a bit passionate about what we're talking about, but thank you so much.
Okay, do we have any more want to come in and take a seat before Ronnie Trudup-Julian comes up? If not, he will come up now and tell you about his platform as to why you should be elected.
Greetings, everyone.
Greetings.
Good to be here this evening. First of all, I'd like to say that it is good to be here in South Jackson, where I am a resident. I have been here half of my life. I stay in the Alterwood subdivision, where my family and I reside. I have three children, a lovely wife who's here tonight. We go to it. Which go to the local public schools here in South Jackson. My children go to Lester Elementary School because I believe that I must be invested in my community. Mm-hmm. I cannot, what I say, what I do, talk is cheap. I believe in action. I've always been a man of action. Anybody who knows me can tell you the work that I've done, my work speaks for itself. I have engulfed and given my entire life since I've been here in South Jackson these past 7 years since I moved to Alderwoods to say I want to spend my life to make South Jackson better. I have invested in t-shirts. I have started actually a nonprofit called the South Jackson Movement because I feel like South Jackson has been the place that people have forgotten about. When I moved to South Jackson in 1993, I was in high school. I was still actually going to Merle High School and tried to go to Wingfield, but I said, hey, I can't go to Wingfield. I got to stay in Merle. But when I stayed here and came to South Jackson, I realized there were a lot of things in South Jackson that had so much potential. South Jackson was a beautiful place. It had a lot of things. Matter of fact, my first job was at the Dairy Queen on Terry Road. When I was 16 years of age, that was my first job. My second job was actually at the Domino's Pizza on Terry Road. My third job was at the UPS on McDowell Road. So South Jackson has been my home. I love South Jackson. I would not leave South Jackson for anything because I believe South Jackson has the potential to make this city great. We all know that if South Jackson was its own city, it would be what the third largest city out there in the state. So, in that, I want to make sure that we don't forget about South Jackson. I want to make sure, like we all gonna say, we want to make sure streets are paved, we want to make sure crime is down. But I want to bring up another topic that I don't think anybody's talking about. We have to invest in our kids and our youth. Right now, our children have nothing to do in this city. Every day, even today, we saw a 15 and a 16-year-old commit a crime, and now they're going to go to jail for the rest of their lives, probably. We want to make sure that we bring programs that we'll have something for the future of our children here. Our motto and our theme is called Let's Rebuild Together. Because I believe one person cannot do this alone. It's going to take all of us working together. Whether that's South Jackson, North Jackson, West Jackson, or wherever. It's going to take all of us working together to make Jackson strong again. Now, I remember when I grew up, like so many of you all, there were things to do for the youth. We had movie theaters. We had skating rinks. We had parks. The Metro Center was the place that all of us hung out. But now, we don't have anything for children to do in this city. So, I decided I wasn't going to wait till I tried to become mayor. I decided, you know what, I have children of my own that I want to invest in. So, we started youth programs at our center called the New Horizons Center in South Jackson, right off of Cooper Road on Wheaton Street. We bought 90 acres over there because we wanted to start a youth camp here in South Jackson for the children of South Jackson and all across this city. Now, I used to work for Young Life Youth Organization, where we went to youth, to the high schools, to the middle school, to tell children there's a better opportunity and a way of life for you. But, like I said, talk is cheap. I was able to recruit already. You can look it up. When I was growing up, I took gymnastics. That was one of the things that I did. Because I believe in doing different type of recreational sports. And I wanted my daughters to have those same experiences. But at the same time, I didn't have time to go to Rensselaer or to Madison to participate in those type of activities. So what I did, I called some guys from Madison and said, hey, I need you to come to South Jackson and start a gymnastics program, which we've already done. Those are the kind of relationships that I have that I'm able to get and recruit people to come to South Jackson or Jackson period to say, we need your help. I'm one of those guys I'm not too proud to be. Because I know it's going to take all of us rebuilding together. I need your help. I need your guidance. I need your wisdom. I'm going to tell you, I don't know everything. I don't claim to know everything. But what I do know is I'm going to serve this city and the citizens the best way possible. Now, one of the things that we've done also is we cleaned up and fixed Terry Road Pool. Now, we see the pools in the city of Jackson right now, a lot of them are looking decayed. There were simple solutions that I got with Councilman Tyrone Hendricks. I said, let's go and repaint that pool on Terry Road. Now, I didn't go around and publicize and say, this is what I've done, but those are things that I've done all across my community, because I believe that South Jackson is a wonderful place to live. Because I believe in engulfing myself in the area and doing whatever I can to bring people back to Jackson. I want to do these same things all over the city of Jackson. Now, I have renovated homes all through South Jackson. We have 20 plus homes right now that we were able to get. They were dilapidated homes, get them, renovate them, and put families in those homes now to live in. Because we didn't want to see another eyesore in our community. Now those things are all over South Jackson, but now we even started to go to West Jackson. Because people started calling me saying we need these same programs in our community too. I didn't wait for the city. I decided we're going to work with our team to make sure we do these type of things all throughout Jackson. So, when I tell you this, what my experience is, people might say, hey, he doesn't have experience in politics. You're absolutely right. What my experience is, I have the experience to get things done. And that's what I bring to the table. I'm not a politician, not by a long shot. I'm a community servant, and I'm going to serve my community, serve my city, and serve you citizens the best way possible. So we want to make sure that when we do something for the youth, that will bring the crime down. Right now, it's those children, those youth that are ages 16 to 23 that are committing most of these crimes. Until we find something for those children to do, the crime is not going to go down. So we want to make sure we bring things back to the city for our children and our youth. We want to recruit those movie theaters to come back. Recruit those skating rinks to come back. Let's bring Metro Center back. Amen. For our children and our youth to shop in, walk around in, and have positive things to do. I mean, when I grew up, right there, not only the Metro Center, but we had the golf park right across the street over there. You had those things you drove around in, go-karts, all those things. We got to bring that stuff back for our youth in our city. We want to rebuild together, not for now, but for our future. Because if we don't do that, it's going to continue to deteriorate in all of our children and our youth. Soon as they graduate high school or college, they're going to leave this city. And I am tired of seeing my friends and everybody else say, I'm leaving Jackson and I'm never coming back. I can promise you this. I don't promise a lot, but I can promise you this. If I become mayor, I can guarantee you I can bring some of those people back. Because what I bring is hope. I bring hope. I don't care what goes on around the city. I don't care how many people talk about South Jackson. I say, I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to stay right here and be the change agent that we can be right here in this community. So don't worry about what somebody says where Jackson deteriorated, I'm going to leave. I'll say, you know what? Well, we can do this together. I can't do this alone. We can do this together. So when a GM decided, hey, on Ellis Avenue, he says, I'm going to leave Jackson. I was able to go to that GM and say, you know what? Don't leave Jackson. Give us one more chance. Come down to South Jackson and come on Terry Road. Because we didn't have a GM in South Jackson. I know we got the one on 18, but right there in Ward 6, you can look it up. When he left that Ellis Shopping Center right there, I recruited him to say, come to South Jackson, because we need a gym for all of us to have those type of services as well. So I've been able to recruit already, not from a standpoint of a politician, even just from a servant in my community, to say, these are the type of opportunities and things that we need all across this city, and I promise you that I can bring those kind of things. So I'm not going to be long. I'm not even going to use those last 5 minutes. Because, like I told you again, to me, talk is cheap. A lot of folks can talk, but I promise you, I can bring some action. God bless.
And he will now come up with his platform and tell you why he should be elected as the next mayor.
I want to first thank Reverend Lyle for opening up the church for us. Let's give him a round of applause. You know, in this campaign, you're going to hear a lot of stuff. And some of it sounds so good, But, you know, the thing that I want you all to remember as you look at who you choose for your next mayor, who can get the job done, who can get results, who can give you the proper respect that you deserve as a taxpayer in Jackson, who can give you an opportunity to see the best come out in Jackson, who can bring the resources to Jackson, who can bring people together, because we can't do this by ourselves. The question that I want you to look at as you look at it in South Jackson, right now, you don't get a lot of respect. South Jackson doesn't get a lot of respect. You've been promised a lot, but folks don't deliver. We've got a situation where our schools, we got 42 out of 58 schools that are either D or F graded school district. We got to turn our schools around. We've got to get the best superintendent that we can find. We've got to get someone who can be a change agent for our school system, because our schools are failing our kids. Our kids aren't failing. Our schools are failing our kids. In South Jackson, people make a lot of promises to you, and they become hollow words. And I think you all are tired. Everybody's tired. Everybody's tired of these bad streets. Everybody's tired of an unwelcome and unpredictable water bill that we paid $90 million to get. Everybody's tired of that. Everybody's tired of the crime. In my speech last week, when we announced our kickoff, I said to the criminals of Jackson, you are no longer welcome here. We are going to shut this revolving door where you can come in and get caught on crime, be put out on bail, go out and commit the same crime, and the revolving door just never seems to shut. We're going to shut that door on crime. I'm sorry, brothers. You know, if you're doing a crime, if you are committing violent crime, if you are doing burglaries and home invasions, we're going to put you away. We're going to put you away because not in our neighborhood. We don't want this anymore. You're not welcome here anymore. And on top of that, if you decide that you're going to turn your life around, we're going to find a place for you in Jackson. We're going to find a place where you can come and be a productive part of a citizen of our community. Because we have too many folks who've had those interactions. And we know that we've got to, if we're going to save our city, we've got to put those people in a position where they can be more productive. South Jackson has a lot of criminal activity. They say the stats are down, but you go by what you're seeing with your own eyes, what your neighbors are seeing, and what they tell you about. The perception and the reality are there. And we've got to do something about crime in South Jackson. We've got to do something about crime all over Jackson. There is no reason that we should have the number of people that we have in South Jackson, and yet all we're getting is Dollar Generals and what's the other one? Family Dollar. Side by side. Makes no sense. I'm an economic developer. That's what I do for a living. I chair the economic development committee in the Senate. We know how to do economic development. Personally, I build houses, for high-end affordable housing for folks. We just put 163 units in over in Carver. We just put, a few years ago, 81 units over in the K Chapel area in Verdon Addition. We know how to do housing. We know how to recruit grocery stores into our community. We did it when Frank Melton asked me and a companion of mine if we would help them to bring grocery stores back into the community. We got those grocery stores reestablished in the community. The Hinds County delegation, and let me just say this, there's no reason that with all the traffic along Highway 18, all the traffic along the interstate, I-55, that we don't have more retail and commercial development in South Jackson.
Amen.
And so somebody in my administration's job is when they wake up every day is to do development in South Jackson. That's their job. That's going to be their job. That's going to be their responsibility. But we've got to restore trust in our system.
folks are just jaded about what they think their government can do. Now, in the 24 years that I served as a state senator, the Hinds County delegation and I delivered $500 million worth of resources from the state of Mississippi to the city of Jackson. I'll give you an example. My first major project, it was the JSU Metro Parkway. And everybody said, oh no, you can't do that. That's not gonna work. The white folks are trying to take over. They wouldn't give black folks that $20 million. And yet 22 years later, we have the JSU Parkway. 6 years ago, we did the 1 cent sales tax. I was the author of that legislation. I'm proud of it because we gave the city of Jackson an opportunity to deliver to itself $280 million. And what happened? 6 years ago, it took 3 years before your local leadership at the city council and the mayor's office decided to give you an opportunity to vote on whether you wanted to tax yourself. Failed leadership. It took another 2 years after they started collecting the money, that they started building roads. And right now, we've only built $5 million of the roads. You know, we got $33 million in the bank. $30 million of it has been obligated, but only $5 million has been spent. What are we waiting for? Why don't we have a sense of urgency about getting things done in Jackson? Why do we wait? It took 10 years to build the parkway. From the time we passed the legislation to the time that it was built. It took 10 years for the telecom center to be built. We gave the city $6 million in emergency funds when we had the big freeze. They just finished spending the money last year. Where is the sense of urgency? And that's all about leadership. It's about whether our leaders are ready to move fast, quick and decisively, and whether they're using our resources wisely. Now, somebody said a minute ago that, oh, it doesn't matter about relationships. Well, if you don't have a relationship, you would say that. You know, but relationships do matter. Relationships count. There is a value in those relationships. And on top of that, the thing that I want folks to understand is who has been getting results for the city of Jackson over and over and over again. Time and time again. So, you know, when the county wants some help, Dr. Lester, they call Creedell Calhoun and John Horn. When the city wants some help from the Lester, they call Creedell Calhoun and John Horn. You know, and it's by no accident that is occurring. We get things done. We get results. And the Hinds County delegation has poured its blood, sweat, and tears into delivering for the city of Jackson. And then we push the resource over, and folks said, well, we don't know if we want that. Let me look at this gift horse in the mouth and see if I really like this gift. And all the while, our roads are getting worse.